there is definitely, as every week, can you turn this down just a little bit, please? There is an anointing of worship, or a spirit of worship. Give me just a little bit of volume, please. Testing. Right there. Last week, the week before, and the week before, has just been a continual service. I thought that the first week that I came into Thirsty Thursday that it was a phenomenal message. It was a great moment where the Spirit would move and people were being ministered to. And everything that has been said from Pastor Ricky, from Brother Shaddon, my father's even said some things, and you know, everybody that has been speaking has all been speaking about the Father's love. I can't think of a better story than to go back to the prodigal son. But I want to bring it tonight with a different viewpoint. I had a couple of worship songs that I was going to do, and as Ricky and I both discussed, we don't know which direction these services go. So what I want to do is I want to just pick up from where Ricky left off in this spirit of worship. And I want to go into two songs here. And I want y'all to pay real close attention. The first one has a little bit of a video with lyrics. The second one is basically lyrics, but they're very profound. And the second one is probably as close to my personal story as I can get. Go ahead.
Your savings, CIBC Fertility Savings Account.
Hallelujah. Y'all just listen to the words of this. Can y'all see that?
Living on my own.
Give me a little volume.
Thinking for myself. Castles in the sand. Temple everywhere. Walls are falling down. Storms are closing in, tears are filling my eye. Here I am again, and I've held out as long as I can. Now I'm lingering, holding out my hand.
Father say to him, make me as one of your hired hands. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired hands. Take it offensive when I'm considered a bride of Christ. I really had my notes laid out to speak more on a word that would reach into people that have been in the streets like I have, and to let them know that, you know, you ain't been in that pig pen by yourself. But as I look across this audience, God is redirecting that because, you know, we know where we've been. And we know the hell we've dealt with. And it ain't just the drugs and the alcohol, but it's the mental and emotional damage that we bring out of that hog pen. And we bring it back into the Father's house.
It can affect your loved ones, your job.
See, Lord, I'm asking you right now, Lord, to just direct me and guide me in what you want said. Lord, you're in control. Holy Spirit, you're in control. There's something deep in my spirit that I feel that needs to be said tonight, and I ask that, God, that you'll orchestrate it in a way that everybody benefits from it. In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
As I began to rehearse some things, because I had written several chapters of my book on sonship, and I based it on the story of the prodigal son that's found in Luke 15. And just today, I felt like that God was redirecting some things, as he always does. And I went upstairs to where my father was, and I had him to pull up some things. And in my quest to look for a certain song that I haven't found yet, I found this song by Brantley Gilbert called Modern Day Prodigal Son. Brother Randy, this is as close to my story as I could get without being graphic. Go ahead and play. Oh, hallelujah.
I said I'm on that in the fast lane bound for freedom. In a truck that Daddy bought me, and my mom would save for school. Laid down all my books and picked up the drinking. Well, I remember now when I gave up a life before. And one reckless night, just looking for my whiskey. Mama gave me in red and white. I read a story about a man who lived just like me. Finally ate his pride and came running home. Lord, I'm a renegade. it right beside. Things back by early morning. Left that bottle I lost right there on the bathroom floor. Stopped at a payphone and called back home to mom. And she might not even talk after all I'd done.
There's some things that parents need to know. I don't think I'm going to be using these notes as usual. You know the story of the prodigal son ended with a son coming home and being restored back to the family, and there was these gifts that were laying in wait. And, you know, we only hear or we read about the ring and the robe and the sandals, which I think are phenomenal gifts of restoration because, you know, sandals are the restoration of a position. A robe is a restoration of royalty, and the ring is a symbolic of the restoration of rulership. But see, there's a whole lot in that story that's not told that you have to read between the lines, Brother Randy, because I'm speaking from personal experience, because I spent 37 years of my life in hell, living a wayward way. And what kept me there, what held me in that position, was not just an addiction to a drug or an alcohol. I'm not expelling that, but there was something more deeper than that. I was hurting inside. I was full of shame. I was full of guilt. Had more regret than you've got seats in this building. It went from recreational use to an addiction. Then all of a sudden it became something that I had to have to survive, to get to another day so that I wouldn't have a mental breakdown. Until it gets to the point that you say, God, I don't care whether I live to see another day. I'm just tired. I'm wore out. I'm weary. I'm tired of pretending like everything's okay. I'm tired of spending all of my time trying to figure out a way to keep this thing going, to have dope in my pocket or whiskey in my bottle. Because they were my sedatives. They were my temporary fixes. My hog pen was sitting by myself, alone and lonely at my kitchen table. And some of y'all, majority of y'all know my story, but I had a bottle of Xanaxes, I had a half gallon of whiskey, and I had enough methamphetamines loaded up in a syringe, and I had to go to Tractor Supply and get a horse needle because I couldn't put as much dope that I wanted to shoot in my arm that night in a regular syringe because I had no intentions of living to see the next day. Like the song said, I cursed the morning sun. As well as cursing God, if this is what you're all about, why do you let me live in this hell? Why do you let me live to see another day? Why do you let me continue to hurt my family, to tear them apart, to break my mother's heart? I say my mother, but I can't realize that I had a father. I had a daddy who longed for me to come home just as much as my mother did.
Amen.
But you see, nowhere in that scripture does it say how long he was in a distant land. There's habits that are formed. There's lifestyles that are developed. And just because I made a decision to come home, Brother Ricky, it didn't change my life.
That's right.
It didn't stop me thinking about the drug or the alcohol. It didn't stop me from remembering all of the guilt and the shame and the people that I've hurt and the faces that are still in my face when I've had my own brother die. Just recently, and I thank God for the fact that my friend wasn't high, he wasn't drinking, but he had come to a place of peace with God, and he's a dear friend of ours, and the sister knows who I'm talking about, you know who I'm talking about. J.T. Molinax was a friend of mine. When I was on the street, and I couldn't get nobody to open the door so that I could lay my head down for just an hour or two or several hours so that I can bring myself, collect myself at least enough to where I can think and make another plan. I couldn't find an open door, but my friend opened his door to me. And he cleared out some clutter in a room and gave me just enough room to lay down. That's what the church is supposed to be doing. Now see, let me paint y'all a picture. The prodigal son asked for his part of the estate. This is the word that the Bible uses. Now, I've said this before and I'm going to say it again tonight. I really think that the father was smart enough not to give him everything that was really his. I think he gave him what... Oh, praise God. See, God can only give you what you think is yours. Is that right, Brother Shaden?
Right, brother. Yes, sir.
You can only receive to the level that you believe.
That's right.
You'll never exceed your belief system. Never. So this wayward son went off. We know the story. We're going to rehearse it a little bit. It says he left and he went off into a distant land and squandered everything on wild living and women. Now, I mean, that's what the Bible says, on women. Amen? Oh, my God. I just got a revelation on that one, Ricky. There's a whole lot of church folks squandering stuff on the wrong woman.
You got that right, brother.
Because a woman is symbolic of the church, but the church has been the church has become the best little brothel.
She's very gaudy, brother. Very gaudy.
Do y'all understand what a brothel is?
Mm-hmm.
Because the duty of a prostitute, oh my God, Ricky, I don't know where this comes from. The duty of a prostitute is to bring pleasure to someone for a moment, to make him feel like a king,
yes,
to make him feel like nothing else matters. The duty of that woman is to moan and groan The problem is the church is moaning and groaning for an hour and a half and they're going back out to the same old stuff. They're getting temporary fixes. So my conclusion, not my conclusion for my entirety of the message, but my conclusion to this is, what's the difference between that and me being on the street and getting a temporary fix through drugs and alcohol?
Sin
is
sin.
Sin's a sin. Only thing is when we read the little list, where's it at? I can't remember where it's at. I ain't good at addresses. It talks about lust and lasciviousness and all that stuff.
Galatians 5.
We want to stop at the big three. But there's a lot longer list. But see, the big three is what we see out here in the world. The rest of it's dealing with the church. Let me get back to my story. Praise God, I get on these rat tracks. So the son goes off, he flounders, he squanders. He's broke, busted, disgusted. Now this is a Jewish boy. And by Jewish law, you ain't even supposed to be within a certain distance of a pig, much less feeding a pig.
That's right.
Now this dude is so hungry, it says that he was willing to eat the pods of the pig. Now, I've heard a lot of people say that that was the corn cobs that he was... No. A pig pod is pig poo-poo.
Oh, my God.
This dude couldn't even eat... Dude.
Right.
Now, let's fast forward a little bit. He gets to thinking because his belly's grumbling. He's hungry. Now, hunger has this unique way of making you start reconsidering some things.
That's right. Uh-huh. Yeah, it does.
Brother Shad, I'm a pretty good size old boy. Even when I was on that street, I maintained my size pretty decent because I like to eat.
Mm-hmm.
And I can eat.
It's coming from Mama herself. Her.
Amen.
Amen.
So when my belly started growling and it felt like my belly button was touching my backbone, I started thinking about home.
Uh-huh.
I got to smelling them fried potatoes, them homemade biscuits, some old big cat head biscuits. I'm talking about them. One of them will just feed your stomach. You know what I'm talking about. Put a slice of tomato on it and some white gravy on top of it. Oh my God, I'm getting hungry. So, hunger has a way of causing you to start reconsidering some things. It starts making you think about home. Now, the prodigal son, or the wayward son, he starts rehearsing this speech, saying, you know what? I got to come up with a speech. I got to get me an acceptance letter.
That's right.
Now, not only does it say how long he was in a distant land, but it don't say how far off that was, neither. I don't think it was a one-day trip. I think it was a long ways off, and that's what it said, a long ways off. So during his travels, not only does he got the smell of poo-poo on him, he's got the smell of the road home. Probably still got a little smell of the woman he was with last week. The smell of whiskey, if you want to make it into the prodigal of the modern day, probably got cigarette smoke smell all over him, just the smell of an old bar. And as he reached a distance when his father had seen him afar off. Now we all have heard this preached, the father was anticipating his return. Always watching, always looking, right?
Hallelujah.
And we've heard that. We've heard it preached. And then he runs out, and we're talking about a Jewish man here, where it's against the law to not only be a certain distance from a pig, but if I was to touch a pig, I can't touch you, Brother Shaq. It makes us both unclean.
That's right.
But the father ran out to meet him. And he threw himself on him, wrapped his arms around him, and began kissing on his son and welcoming his son home. And then all of a sudden this dude's like, I've got to get this speech out. So that I can let Daddy know, huh, look, I'll be all right. I'll be all right in the servant's quarter. Just make me a hired hand here. But the father never heard that because the father's voice was overriding the son's voice when he started shouting back to the servants, bring me out the robe. Bring me out the ring. Bring me out the sandals. We're fixing to celebrate this thing. You know, he put the ring on. Look, he didn't tell him to go get a shower.
No.
Nowhere, Brother Shaddon, have I found that he said, son, all right, we got some conditions here. Before I let you, now I had some conditions when it comes to my daddy. He said, son, you're going to sit down. We're going to discuss some things before I let you in my door. Amen. I'm not taking nothing away from that. That's wisdom. Because me and my brothers were something serious. My younger brother was. God Almighty, I ain't going to discuss that one, but I love him my whole heart, but boy, he was a handful. But anyway, Pastor Dorks knows what I'm talking about. But this is the thing. My dad said, under my roof, you live by my rules. Now, I'm not taking nothing away from that, because you need healthy boundaries.
Yes.
Even when it comes to your own children.
Amen.
Amen.
But we're not talking about the natural here. We're talking about the spiritual. We're talking about Daddy. Abba, Father. Daddy, Daddy. Now this is the thing. He threw himself on his son. He began kissing. He took the robe of righteousness and wrapped it around a man who was covered in pig poo-poo. A unclean, inside and out, Jewish boy was restored unto righteousness when the robe was wrapped around him. He was restored into right standing in the family when the sandals was put on his feet, because the sandals were symbolic of royalty also, because only royalty, only the royal family wore sandals. Only the servants were not allowed to wear sandals. And the ring is symbolic of authority.
Yeah.
It was what they always used. Anytime anything was written out, a scroll or anything, when it was sealed up, they would stamp it with that signet ring, marking that it was signed by royalty. Amen. It also is for access. Now, let me fast forward because I know we're running out of time. The Father said, now I've heard it preached many, many times, Brother Shed, go kill the fatty calf.
Right.
That's not what it says.
Right.
It said, bring me the fatty calf.
Right.
Right here.
Yeah.
And we're going to kill it. And we're going to shed the blood of this bull because I'm not going to allow my son to take another step towards this house until I restore him fully in his new covenant. Because in the Old Testament, under Jewish law, the signing of a covenant had to be by the spilling of blood.
Yeah.
Is this okay?
Yeah.
Now, they're celebrating. The party's in full swing. Just because I made a decision to come home didn't stop my mind from remembering where I've been.
Amen.
Just because I made a decision to come home, Brother Shed, didn't stop those damaged emotions from trying to still rule my life.
Uh-huh. You're right.
Because something as simple as a smile or a tear that runs down your mama or your daddy's cheeks will stir those emotions up, and they're like a lioness after its prey. Those emotions, they'll do one or two things. They'll either just instantly bombard you to the point that it'll hold you where you're at, or it'll silence itself through your travels coming back home. And it'll wait for a moment when you're at your weakest point, when your guard is down, and all of a sudden you feel affection that you don't think you deserve. And then all of a sudden you find yourself running towards the servants' quarters where you think you belong. For me, it was a basement. I became a basement dweller. I still stay in a basement, but the atmosphere is so much different because I lived almost in a solitude way, in just an old, dark, cold basement where, you know, you still had the funky smell of mildew. Because it's where I thought I deserved to be. Because I wasn't worthy enough to go upstairs where the celebration was. I wasn't worthy to mingle with other family members that I held at a higher level than I thought I was. Is this okay?
Yes, sir.
So, for the mothers and the fathers, the aunts, the uncles, or anybody that's a caretaker, dealing with recovering addicts, you never really know how to act. You really never know. There's no formula. It's a moment by moment, day by day, week by week situation. Because you never know what's going through our heads at the time. Because we become professional pretenders, masters of our emotions. One thing me and my brothers used to hate to hear was our daddy saying, "Son, what do you mean? Explain yourself." I'm sitting there thinking to myself, please don't put me through this again. Just leave me alone. And it wasn't until this last time, and my mother and my father both are here tonight, and I praise God for them, because without them, getting to a point that they would let me be real and let me be expressive in my emotions without some kind of religious do's and don'ts over my head.
Yes, sir.
How are you today, Ken? Used to be something I feared to hear, because I knew I would have to lie and say, oh, I'll be all right. But it finally got to a point, Brother Ricky, I told him, I'm falling apart. I feel like I'm in hell.
Yes, sir.
How are you emotionally? It sucks right now.
Yeah.
My last moments, my mom and dad just sit patiently for me to come to them instead of them trying to rescue me. I can only imagine how hard it was for them to sit and wait, wondering if I was going to pull through or not. And when you was talking about talking to God, communicating with God, it's okay to be mad at God.
Yes, sir.
Didn't bother him.
He can he's a big boy.
Yes.
You're not going to hurt his feelings. You're not going to make him pull his hands away from you. You can't do it. It's impossible.
Mm-hmm.
But see, there's these little voices that remain in our head. And you know, I'm going to rewind just a minute, and you know, I can picture this prodigal or wayward son, and he's in the house, and all of a sudden he sees where he used to lay his head. He sees where his meals used to be prepared. There's this banqueting table that just stretches off from one end of the house to the other, and the festivities are in full swing, and all of a sudden he walks back into his bedroom, and he remembers his childhood moment. And then all of a sudden, he starts thinking, well, would Daddy be doing this if he really knew where I've been? Would he really be throwing this kind of party if he knew I was sticking needles in my arm? Would he still be doing this if he knows that I've been a thief? A beggar, a manipulator, a liar. These are the things that we deal with. So if there's someone in your life that you're trying to reach out to, a little bit goes a long ways. You know, I'm going to just have to use illustrations that I'm familiar with. When I want to catch a raccoon in a trap, I throw a little bit nuggets way out there. I put my little trail down through there. I put the real meat in the cage. Because I got to entice them to get in that cage so that the trap door can fall down. I'm not saying y'all trap your loved ones in a situation. But if you don't know how to deal with it, in my case, I had some real serious problems and I needed some real professional help. And trust me, I don't think nobody in here is a professional. Sometimes we do need to get somewhere secluded. When I say secluded, I'm not talking about poked back somewhere in some dark corner somewhere. For me, I had to dedicate a whole year of my life, Brother Neil. When I got up off that kitchen floor that night, I made my mind up that I was going to trust God for a change. It was a take it all or nothing deal. Now, I was the one doing the dealing, you know. Well, God, now this is going to be the way it is. And that now I guess, you know, that kind of gives me an understanding as to why God made man on the sixth day, not the first, second, third, fourth, fifth. I really think there's a reason behind that. Because if he made me on any other day, I'd be trying to tell him what I needed.
That's right.
I'd be trying to help him create. No, God, that ain't the way to do it. Wait a minute. That's kind of sound churchy, don't it? I've come to a conclusion. God does his best work when man's asleep.
That's right.
Amen? Mm-hmm. Started with that. Well, praise God, I'm glad he put him to sleep too. Because when he was asleep, he created the woman.
That's right.
He done his best work in Abraham's life when Abraham was asleep. Am I right, Brother Rick?
Yes, sir.
All of the miracles that I read about in the New Covenant or the New Testament was all done on the Sabbath. Am I right, Brother Chad? You ever thought why? I don't think he was trying to be a rebel. I don't think he was trying to just bust up a religious system, although that's, you know, that might have been an underlying, you know, issue. But the thing of it was that's when everybody was at rest. It was the day of rest. They couldn't work. They couldn't do nothing. And, you know, even true Jewish law, they had to even, and I won't get more in a modern day, but this is a fact, because I know some Jewish people, they would have to take their toilet paper off the day before because they weren't even allowed to pull toilet paper off the roll. If they had forgot, then they can hire a Gentile to do it for them.
Oh, my goodness.
I mean, seriously. Do you know that? I didn't either, but now that came from a Jewish person. So, I mean, if you got a poo-poo on Sunday, guess what? You don't pull your toilet paper on Saturday, you better have a Gentile in the house.
You'll find one.
Amen. Is anybody getting anything out of this?
Yeah. Learning all kinds of stuff.
Let me say this, and I'm going to close because I think we've been here long enough. For those who have been in my shoes, and the way of the prodigal, or the way of the wayward son. Stop beating yourself up.
Yeah.
You know, what we need to know is that we are the Father's sons.
Yeah.
He's not looking for you to change, to conform to his way, just so that you can be accepted by him.
That's right.
He's looking you to run and jump into his lap. And it's his love that will change you.
Yeah.
I'm going to say this, and the Apostle Jerry Deutsch, the bishop of this ministry, I believe he will agree with me with this. This is a come-as-you-are church.
Right.
No dress codes. I mean, you can kind of tell that. I've done preaching overalls, might as well preach in shorts. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
So, we don't have a set of rules. We don't have a set of regulations. We don't have a list of do's and a list of don'ts. I don't even know if we even have membership cards, do we?
You're a member if you're saved.
We're all a member of one body.
Yeah, that's right.
This is just only one branch of the body. You know, the hand has got fingers, got knuckles, got fingernails. So if this church is the extension or the outreach of the ministry, it's still got to be connected to an arm somewhere.
Yeah.
Now we're too caught up in religious doctrines and denominations that we forget that we're the body of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
So be good to yourself. Pat yourself on the back. Remind yourself that you're a child of God first and foremost.
Yeah.
And if you slip up, so what? Because change don't come overnight. Does it, brother?
Still.
When you first got saved, was you an instant Christian like that and you knew everything? I wasn't either. I still have little issues.
Still growing.
I'm still dealing with some stuff. Amen, all like that. Brother Ricky, I'm gonna just turn this back over to you. I'm done.
Before you stop me, I'm a Christian.
Well, amen. Praise God. Praise God.
How would you like? When the memories are no longer holding any pain.
Yeah.
True forgiveness is when the pain and the hurt and the anguish is gone.
Yeah.
God says, I'm bringing true forgiveness to your heart.
Yeah.
To let go of your unforgiveness to yourself.
Yeah.
Because that's when healing comes.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that the memories will leave. It means that you'll look back and say, God, I remember when you delivered me from that.
Yeah.
These memories bring no more harm.
Hallelujah.
They only bring memories of deliverance. When you saved me and you gave me your freedom.
Yeah.
Father, I thank you right now for healing in my brother's heart, Father. God, as you brought this to me, Father, you'll bring it to him because you're not a respecter of person.
Amen.
We don't live in the traps of the enemy, but we are delivered from the traps of the enemy.
Yes.
As you chose the children of Israel when they come across the Red Sea to build an altar, not to remind them of the bondage and the hurt, but remind them of the freedom that you gave them when you said, when you cross over the river, that you'll never see these anymore. And you'll be free from now on. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Real quick, I want to leave y'all with one word. If you don't remember nothing else tonight, I want you to remember this. God cannot reward you with something that already belongs to you by an inheritance. So when we think that we're working to obtain a reward, or, you know, even when we have this servant, and when I say the word servant, you know, in this scenario, I'm speaking of a slave mentality.
Yeah.
Anytime you have a slave mentality,
yeah,
and you're laboring and you're trying to obtain something, and you know, just like you work during the week and then you get paid, you know, you're laboring for a pay and or a reward, right? So when we get caught up in labors or works mentality, and we're seeking a reward of grace or a reward of righteousness. Look, God can't give that to you as a reward.
That's right.
It's already yours by an inheritance.
Yes. Oh, yes.
It's already yours. So the bottom line is this. I'm all about understanding who we are. I'm all about identity, knowing who we are.
Amen.
Because when you understand who you are, when you know who you are, you gain authority.
Yeah.
Now this is what I close with. Brother Neil, did you know that, let me make sure, Lord, help me make sure I say this right. Restoration. I hope I'm saying this right. Restoration is not simply so that you can come and be in the house of God.
Right.
Restoration is symbolic of our salvation.
Yeah.
So what are we getting saved from? We're getting saved from a religious mentality.
That's right.
Right?
Yes, sir.
So we move out of religion because that redemption is for a relationship.
Yes, it is.
So we move out of religion. We're redeemed from that. We're,
yes,
we're saved from that. So we move out of religion into a relationship.
Yes.
That's when we crawl up in Betty's lap. We tell him what we think, how we feel. Look, if they've heard me talk to God, they'd be trying to string me up and call me a hypocrite. Because they can get vocal. And I don't censor my language. But God loves it. God loved David. David was so real with God that he said, that's a man after my own heart. But we move from religion into a relationship. And out of that relationship, you develop rulership.
That's right. Yes, sir.
Because all that the Father has is yours.
That's right.
So what you do is you move out of relationship, you move out of religion into a relationship.
Yes.
That relationship is going to produce rulership. Know who you are.
Amen. Right.